are four steps to making buildings that fight climate change that everyone should know. Why focus on buildings when it comes to climate change? Well, first, most of our buildings now are really bad at protecting us from climate impacts. Dealing with a heat dome or a cold snap and the power goes out, you're kind of screwed. Your house will either cook or freeze because it's leaky and poorly insulated. Hammered by a big wildfire smoke event, chances are your indoor air quality will go down the tubes and you'll be choosing between battening down the hatches and creating stale, hypoxic conditions inside, meaning too much CO2 for good cognitive function, or opening up your house to toxic smoke with potentially lifelong impacts. Most of our buildings just aren't up to the challenges that climate change is already throwing at us, and that's got to change. But to add insult to injury, our buildings are also a massive contributor to the climate crisis. Buildings currently account for fully one-third of human-caused carbon emissions, according to the International Energy Agency and Architecture 2030. Here's how those building emissions break down. Just over 80% comes from the energy burned to operate our buildings, and just under 20% comes from the energy and processes used to construct them. So, buildings are a big climate problem, but it doesn't have to be this way. On to the four steps of making buildings that fight climate change. By the way, what's so cool is that these four steps are overwhelmingly mutually reinforcing, mutually supportive. So the first step is energy efficiency. And when I say energy efficiency, I'm not talking about little incremental energy efficiency improvements that tinker around the edges. I'm talking about passive house levels of transformative energy efficiency. Now, I know, you're like, dude, you work for the passive house accelerator, so of course you're going to talk up efficiency and passive house. So predictable. And I hear you, I really do. So two things. First, the reason that the passive house movement exists and that the passive house accelerator exists and that passive house is becoming building code in more and more places is that people are excited that we can use building science to make super efficient, healthy buildings affordably. Second, we can call this process anything we like. It doesn't have to be passive house. We're just enthusiastic about the approach and the result. If folks can get the result with a different approach, that's awesome. That's what matters. So having gotten that out of the way, we collectively are getting really good at energy efficiency in buildings, like really good. And that's important because when buildings waste energy, they cause massive carbon emissions, as we saw from those statistics earlier. And while the clean energy transition is incredibly encouraging, like we really might do this thing, our energy today is still dirty, and the transition will take time. This is true even in places like Seattle, where people assume that hydro makes our electrons zero carbon. The truth is that those electrons get mixed into a big dirty energy grid. So consuming electricity in Seattle is as carbon intensive as it is in Western Montana. And many of us will still have dirty energy until 2035, even 2050. So we need to reduce the amount of energy our buildings use now. The good news is that passive house buildings can reduce building energy demand by half or more and do it cost effectively. Apartment buildings in Boston are doing it for just 2 to 3% more than code minimum buildings in terms of upfront construction costs. Affordable housing providers are among the leaders and early adopters of passive house, in part because these buildings provide energy security, and in part because they provide climate resilience to their clients. So step one to making buildings that fight climate change is applying transformative energy efficiency to new and existing buildings because it slashes operational carbon emissions right now and for years to come. Step two is to reduce upfront carbon emissions, also known as embodied carbon emissions. Remember that statistic that just under 20% of building emissions comes from the energy and processes used to construct buildings? That's what we're after here. Unlike the energy efficiency movement, this movement to reduce upfront emissions is much younger, and we're on a steep learning curve. Groups like the Carbon Leadership Forum, Building Transparency, RMI, and Builders for Climate Action are leading the way for us. The really big upfront carbon culprits are concrete and steel, and even wood can be a net emitter if not sustainably harvested. So the structure of buildings is really important here. but essentially every element of a building has a carbon footprint. Luckily, innovations in concrete mixes, green steel, biogenic materials, and a bunch more are providing ways for us to reduce upfront emissions, often at little or no extra cost. And some products, like compressed straw panels, can actually sequester carbon, which is pretty exciting. And here's where things get really interesting in terms of energy efficiency and low embodied carbon architecture being mutually reinforcing. Imagine a passive house built with an inherently energy efficient, simple form, because by avoiding zigs and zags, you're avoiding energy sapping thermal bridges and making it easier to achieve continuous insulation around the building. And imagine that insulation being low embodied carbon or even carbon sequestering. You've reduced the embodied carbon emissions from the structure of the building by simplifying the building's form and therefore simplifying its structure. And you've sequestered carbon in the insulation. So those energy efficiency design moves not only will reduce operational carbon emissions, they'll also help reduce upfront carbon. The third step to making buildings that fight climate change is to electrify everything. Rewiring America is a great group to follow here. Anyway, we've got to stop burning fossil fuels inside our buildings. Heat pumps can heat and cool our buildings, heat our water, and can do it all super efficiently. In this way, electrifying everything increases energy efficiency. And it goes both ways. When we create passive house buildings, they require very little heating or cooling. So their heat pumps can be much smaller, which means lower upfront carbon from that equipment, of course, but also much smaller volumes of refrigerant, which can have a very big emissions impact. And of course, the beauty of electrifying our buildings is that as the clean energy transition progresses, the carbon intensity of the energy that our buildings consume curves to zero. Which brings us to the fourth step, and that's to get our electricity from clean sources. That can mean installing solar panels on site wherever possible, participating in community solar, and on a societal level, supporting the construction of renewable energy generation, transmission capacity, and the expansion of our clean energy grid. Because when it comes to clean energy, now is the time for YIMBY, or yes in my backyard. A transition to super efficient buildings would really help here too. It would reduce overall energy load, of course, but even more important, it would flatten the winter peak in demand that is currently caused by all that heating of our inefficient, leaky buildings. All this would mean that less overbuild of the clean energy grid would be necessary for the clean energy transition to succeed. So there you have it, the four steps to making buildings that fight climate change. But none of this works if these buildings don't work for people. If they don't create healthy havens to weather the climate impacts that are already here. If they can't be affordable and accessible to everyone. If they can't be places where we all can thrive. And I have to say, from where I sit at Passive House Accelerator with all our programming and all these examples of built projects, of enlightened policymaking, of market transformation, that every day we have more and more proof of concept that this does work, that we can change buildings from a massive climate problem to a massive climate solution. So I hope you join us in making buildings that fight climate change and that help build a brighter future for everyone. Thanks for watching.